Here we are at the wonderful stinking creek, Tianmu Creek, Sulfur Creek, on this fine April evening here in Beitou, Taiwan. It's time for a little Shakespeare. It's been a while since our last piece that we did, our last effort. And for this one, it's 6 sonnets. I think Shakespeare wrote 154 of them, around there. And they're very interesting. Of course, if you just hear them or read them, they're very difficult to understand. But once you study what the meanings of them are, you know, the archaic words and whatnot, they really are incredibly deep and beautiful. And for me, it's just more practice. So let's get started. The first sonnet, and I'll do these in some kind of order, is sonnet 29. When in disgrace with fortune in men's eyes, I all alone bleat my outcast state, and trouble deaf heaven with my bootless cries, and look upon myself, and curse my fate, wishing me, like to one more rich in hope, featured like him with friends possessed, desiring this man's art and that man's scope with what I most enjoy, contented at least, yet in these thoughts, myself almost despising. Happily I think on the end of my state, like to the lark at break a day arising from sullen earth, sings hymns at heaven's gate, for thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, but then I scorn to change my state with kings. Sonnet 44. If the dull substance of my flesh were thought, injurious distance should not stop my way, for then despite of space I would be brought from limits far remote where thou dost stay. No matter then, although my foot did stand upon the farthest earth removed from thee, for nimble thought can jump both sea and land as soon as think the place where he would be. But ah, thought kills me that I am not thought to leap large lengths of miles when thou art gone. But that so much of earth and water wrought, I must attend time's leisure with my moan, receiving not from elements so slow, but heavy tears, badges of either's woe. And that last line should be, receiving not by, that's okay, let that one slide. Now, sonnet 45, which is a continuation of sonnet 44. The other two, slight air and purging fire, both with thee, wherever I abide, the first my thought, the other my desire. These, present, absent, with swift motion slide. For when these quicker elements are gone in tender embassy of love to thee, my life being made of four, with two alone, sinks down to death oppressed with melancholy, until life's composition be recurred by those swift messengers returned from thee, who even but now come back again, assured of your fair health, recounting it to me. This told, I joy, but then no longer glad, I send them back again and straight grow sad. 64. When I have seen by time's fell hand to face the rich, proud cost of outworn, buried age, when sometime lofty towers I see downraised, and brass eternal slave to mortal rage, when I have seen the hungry ocean gain advantage on the kingdom of the shore, and the firm soil wind of the watery main increasing store with loss, and loss with store. When I have seen such interchange of state, and state itself confounded to decay, ruin hath taught me thus to ruminate, time will come and take my love away. This thought is as a death, which cannot choose, but weep to have that which it fears to lose. Sonnet 116. Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediments. Love is not love, which alters when it alteration finds, or bends with the remover to remove. Oh no, it is a never fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. It is the star to every wandering bark, whose worth's unknown, although his height be taken. Love's not time's fool, though rosy lips and cheeks within his bending sickle's compass come. Love alters not his brief hours and weeks, but bears it out even to the edge of doom. If this be error, and upon me proved, I never writ, nor no man ever loved. Of course, back then, prove and love sounded very similar. So, proved and loved. And the last of these six is one of the ones I really enjoy, perhaps more than all of them, because it has a lot of truth to it, I think, with the human condition. And it is Sonnet 129. The expense of spirit in a waste of shame is lust in action. And till action, lust is perjured, murderous, bloody, full of blame. Savage, extreme, rude, cruel, not to trust. Enjoyed no sooner, but despised straight, past reason hunted. And no sooner had past reason hated, as a swallowed bait on purpose laid to make the taker mad, mad in pursuit and in possession so. Had, having, and in quest to have extreme, a bliss and proof improved, a very woe. Before a joy proposed, behind a dream. All this the world well knows, yet none knows well to shun the heaven that leads men to this hell. There you have it. I might have made a couple of mistakes, but probably pretty close. And there's another one for the archives.